is similar, of course, to the presentation that I gave last fall, which probably most of you have read or heard at the time, when we were discussing what came out of the 1960s, the civil rights movement tragedy and the Labor Committee emergence. But the theses are as follows. One, that we are the only philosophical association on the world scene which is able to deal with the crisis of civilization today. Second, that we have already in our 25 years of existence approximately produced the ideas and institutions that have changed history. And the third purpose of this class is the confidence on my part that understanding our history will make you all more effective in the tasks that lie before us in the period ahead. Now, this class could be approached in many ways. In a way, you could say the history of Lynn, right? Lynn's intellectual history, his organizations, and so forth. Presumably, most of you have read The Power of Reason. If you haven't, you can read along with that as well, because it does deal with the same period, obviously, from the standpoint of Lynn's biography. And I could, if I wished, provide you with a whole class of everything that Lynn has ever written that's in my house that probably would fill up at least the front half of this room in terms of not only internal documents, formal papers, letters, which Lynn was a voluminous letter writer to people in political movements all around the world, lecture notes, so forth and so on. But I'm not doing that. I'm not going to bring out all the juicy internal documents for this particular class, and perhaps not at all. It all depends on how you react. But I think that would be too narrow for our purpose here. The fact is that the genius of Lynn and of other great men in history is that they, to some degree or another, changed the world, reproduced ideas that change other people and recruit other people. And it's Lynn's collaboration with others in creating these institutions and ideas with institutional forms that have generated fights that have been formative in the history of this country and the world, and that have situated us in history in such a way that we can move ahead to do what needs to be done right now. Now, Lynn himself has written some histories of the Labor Committee. The first one he wrote, which I'm not going to provide to you, was done back in 1974 when he was still going under his pen name, L. Marcus. And that's Lynn right there. And that's Muriel Mirac in the back, and so forth and so on. This is 1974, we're now more than 20 years later. At that time, Lynn had already identified six periods of the Labor Committee's existence from 1966 to 1974. So you can imagine that I can't really go into the history of the Labor Committee in as much detail as he himself might have done. He wrote a second one in 1979, which was called What Are the Labor Committees Today? At a crucial turning point, in fact, when we were going into the Democratic Party. But we'll get to that much later. And then the third one was done more from Lynn's personal standpoint in 1985 on his political career, what are LaRouche's motives and efforts in public life, which does deal also with the question of the Labor Committee. Now, I am going to deal with this in chronologically, six or seven parts. You may get a little bit of audiovisual, but not much. In 1979, we did a 10-year anniversary of the newspaper, New Solidarity. And at that time, there was a slideshow produced, which I'm actually capable of giving. But it's about 140 slides. They're real rapid. They're not, you don't have to study them hard. There are a lot of cartoons and things like that. But at some point, probably when we hit 1979, I will show that slideshow, because I think that you will find it amusing. I'm not going to organize this so much even around the timeline perspective of how we were right on everything. I mean, I could do that, right? I could take themes from economics, I could take themes from culture, and so forth and so on. In part, I don't want to do that because I want to give you the flavor of the evolution that we went through. I mean, it's Lynn's argument that, and I believe it to be true, that the central concepts, which he built the organization on, and which we were recruited on, were organically the same as they are right now, and I think that will become clear. Although, you know, the form was quite different. The directionality and the implicit content of the method and principles were largely the same. Now, what were those? The first, which, and this was quite radical at the time within the radical movement, is that it was ideas produced by individual minds which are the causal actor in history and economy. Now, you think of Lynn within a Marxist environment making that argument, and you know that he wasn't your normal Marxist, since he was constantly had to argue with absolutely everybody about the question of ideas creating the state of the economy as opposed to material forces, objective forces, and so forth like that. Secondly, it was always our assertion that scientific and technological progress were essential. This was an argument also immediately with the milieu from which we arose, because you're talking about a period in which the critics of the financial system and economy in the late 1960s generally were criticizing it on the basis of there being bad distribution of wealth, or even overproduction of wealth, or overconsumption in the so-called advanced sector, which is the United States, versus the rest of the world. The whole idea that actually you still see in France, I was very surprised to see this during the election, of, remember Jospin's jobs policy was what we used to call here in the United States 30 for 40, which is that you work 30 hours a week for 40 hours of pay. And the idea was, well, there wasn't, we were already producing enough that everyone should get paid more to work less, just in order to redistribute the wealth. Now, that was obviously insane when you looked at the fact that we weren't producing anything like what was required in housing, in energy, not to mention what Lynn always used to talk about, which was a deficit of approximately $25 trillion worth of requirements, what he would say, below the Tropic of Cancer. Now, you all know where that is. I mean, that's just basically the southern hemisphere of Africa, India, Latin America, and Asia, all totally impoverished. So we had a huge argument with these guys from the very with everybody around us. And then, of course, in terms of non-left circles, so to speak, you had the growing dogma of the post-industrial society, which had come on the scene in a big way with the triple revolution thesis in the early 1960s as well, which also said, basically, your problem here is that you've got a bad distribution of wealth. And if we redistribute it, everything will be just fine. And the third thing that constantly was emphasized by Lynn in all his classes and to challenge everybody was the fact that you're dealing not only with the fact that great minds have been the cause of moving history, that science and technological progress are necessary, but that every individual has to find their, has the ability to be what someone would call, we certainly used to call, world historical. That every individual has the ability to impact the direction of history. And you have to conceive of your identity as affecting the course of history. And the way that you conceive that in particular is through the effect that you have on the ability of the economy and society to expand to improve the lot of the rest of humanity through, in other words, through economics and physical economy, as Lynn has said over and over again. The most famous, I tried very hard to come up with a joke to start this class with, because Lynn has the assertion that in this 1979 history that most of the people who stuck with him were the ones who liked or endured his jokes throughout all his classes. Now, I have to say that I can't really remember them that well, but I did endure them, obviously, since I was there close to the beginning. But and I think I've developed something of a sense of humor through the course of the entire period. But the joke that he would continually tell would be, or the image that he would continually use, which was a cartoon, was an Abner Dean cartoon. I don't know how many of you are aficionados of cartoonists, but this was a guy who had a cartoon of a man being carried out in a coffin and sort of looking up and saying, what was that all about? In terms of what was my life all about? That was what Lynn was posing to everyone who came to the class. What is your life all about? You have to look at it. Well, you don't know by just knowing how you feel, by just knowing whether you have good relations with people around you, if you have a meaningful relationship. I mean, this is the 1960s, folks. I mean, or whether you only know by knowing how the world works, especially its economy, and whether you're making a contribution to it moving in the right direction or not. World historical. Now, we all thought, and I suspect Lynn thought this too at the time, that these ideas were real socialism, as opposed to what they did in the Soviet Union, what they did in China. We hated them entirely, certainly as opposed to any group in the United States that represented itself as a left-wing group, that they were all total idiots. But that somehow, you know, underneath it all, and even a whole lot of the junk in Marx, you know, that underneath it all, these ideals were, and principles were the essence of it. It became clearer and clearer to us as we learned more that this was not true. So the ideas didn't change, but the historical identification with them changed. I mean, for one thing, the essence of what we were all about was being intellectuals, you know, which Lynn repeated again and again. We had big fights with everybody around us on that question of those who were going to the working class and joining a factory to see what the workers felt like and get along with them and see what, you know, talk baseball, talk soccer, and, you know, and bore from within, they used to call it, so that eventually at the time that a strike would happen, that you would be the best liked guy in the shop, you know, and you could tell them what to do. That kind of garbage, as opposed to being intellectuals, understanding ideas, the way the world worked, and bringing that and educating people, that it's an educated leadership and intellectuals that are going to make the difference. Totally against pragmatism, and committed to a universal world outlook. So, I mean, this did, I mean, from before Lynn decided to found the Labor Committee, it had him at odds with absolutely everybody that he knew, practically, although they often found him useful in terms of being discussing ideas. But this is the basis on which the Corps was recruited. Now, the first period that I'm going to deal with is 1966 to 1971. But I'm going to go, I'm actually, and I have the chart back there, but that actually goes further than I'm going to go today. That goes through the whole year of 1971. But in fact, 1966 is when LaRouche gave his first class at a university in New York City and began to assemble the grouping of people to form his own organization. And he had determined at this point that it was impossible to go into any of these other organizations who were critical of the war, who were critical of the poverty, who were critical of the way in which the whole society was going, because all they were trying to do was not figure out how to change the way the economy was organized or society was organized, but simply to build up chits and friends and influence and power with no concept behind it whatsoever. So it was all a matter of, and in fact, by the time that Lynn decided to do this, he could very well see that the major groups on the left, for example, the SWP, the Trotskyists, Socialist Workers Party, in case you've never heard of them, and the Communist Party, and you probably don't find them very much nowadays because mostly they've gone into the Democratic Party. And the major place we've seen them in Virginia over the past number of years is the people who were most hysterical against us in the Mary Sue campaign, we think were old Communist Party members who were in the Democratic Party. But at that time, they were major groupings in their own name, heavily in the anti-war movement, but they were also beginning to orient themselves to what they considered the most radicalized people in the population who were going to supposedly be effective in changing the system, making a revolution, whatever. And these were blacks. So you had a heavy and totally ironic promotion by the SWP and the CP of black-only organizations, where, of course, most of them weren't black at all, so you'd have to set up an organization that you couldn't even go into. There was a whole concept that they pushed of black skin privilege. Right? If you were black and you'd been impressed all these many years, you know, then a white person couldn't tell you anything because you had suffered all this time and so forth. This is the way they were organized. And they were, in other words, organizing to exacerbate racial tensions in the United States. Then the other radical area was women, radical women's groups. And then you get into the homosexuals and the whole five sexes. You know, that's what there are, I'm told now. There are five sexes. Don't tell me to elaborate them because I don't think I can, but that's the official dogma, and it all began in the 1960s, I think, officially. So that's what these groups were doing. They were orienting to the radicalized sections of society, the most oppressed sections of society, not with any idea of what to do with them or to improve their lot, but to bring them together with other groups in society, but to radicalize them further, to demand for themselves, to create a bigger crisis for the system, and so forth and so on. So this was worthless as far as Lynn was concerned. He would have to take what he knew and form an organization on his own as opposed to working within these organizations based on these non-ideas or totally destructive ideas, in fact. So I'm going to take you from the classes to January of 1971, which is the period in which, in January 1971, we had a conference where we had a split, and we lost about 80 people, I think, came out of that conference with 120 people. At that point, we basically got rid of a lot of opportunists at that time, and were set to look to go into the period of financial crisis that erupted later in August of that year. We were out of the student movement. We were ready to, and the student movement was basically, and the New Left pretty much entirely, so-called New Left, and on the national political stage by the time we got to that, to January 1971. I believe January 1971 is also the first time we were attacked by the Soviet government in a Greek Soviet CP publication called Neos Cosmos, ran an attack on Lynn in January of 1971. So that, in a way, you could say is a credential that we had reached on the international stage. Now, what were the critical ideas that Lynn was putting forward at this, in this, these initial classes? And you should realize that all of these initial classes involve people coming together to listen and talk and then deploying. Because the whole idea was you had to read and study, yes, but then you had to go out and see if you could convince other people of what you had learned and studied, and then come back with the questions and the problems that you had. This was not a purely academic exercise, although it was much more thoughtful than anybody else in the so-called activist left scene or political scene at the time. So the first idea, which was totally unique, was that we were in, which you've heard many times in the economic timeline, is the assertion that we were in a conjunctural strategic crisis. In other words, there was going to be a conjuncture, which is a coming together of the crisis in the economy, crisis between states in wars, and a social crisis that was going to create an upheaval that where the right solutions had to be on the scene, or else you were going to have a disaster. So we weren't going to go ahead for the next 50 years with the economy functioning. We weren't going to, which is the way most people thought, the laws of history were going to change. We were going to come into a period of a strategic conjuncture, particularly with the danger of fascism, not this time on a national scale, but on an international scale. That what happened in Germany in terms of looting people and accumulating wealth from them in order to prop up a system was going to happen in the world as a whole if the right activity was not taken in this conjuncture. So we went after that from an economic standpoint as an international question. We also went at it from the danger of fascism on a cultural level, which we've gone through somewhat at the recent conferences, that the kind of sexual liberation and homosexuality and drug culture and rock music and irrationalism, celebration of irrationalism, that this was the same kind of thing that happened before Nazism in Germany, and that was the same kind of thing that was destroying people, was happening in the United States in particular, but not just the United States, also throughout the rest of particularly the advanced sector. The argument that Lynn made at that time was very similar to the argument that he makes in the ninth forecast. There has got to be a disintegration. It will happen. He wasn't putting the time frame that he thought it would happen in was a little bit closer by the end of the 1970s, but it was the fundamentals of what would cause that crisis, in particular the discrepancy between the physical economy and the fictitious values being created by rents, stocks, bonds, and other paper that was being generated, was precisely the same as it is right now. So, in fact, I'll say that later. And then what we posed in course of this is that if you're going to have a strategic conjunctural crisis, you're going to have monetary convulsions, you're going to have economic disasters, that the only way for an organizer to approach this is to present the solution, the programmatic reconstruction solution to this crisis. Don't just try to make it worse in hopes that, you know, like the communists did in 1930s in Germany, the worse the better, and hope that something, you know, when the crisis happens, someone's there to come up with a solution, but present what the economic reconstruction solution is. And a lot of what we did was to go into these meetings of students, go into these meetings of anti-war protesters and so forth, where they had teach-ins, and say, we need reconstruction, right? This is the kind of reconstruction. You have to learn economics. You have to know how the world economy is connected. You have to have you can't have a war of the oppressed of the society against the what today you'd call the middle class. At that point, you would have called it the working class, the better off workers of the construction workers, the auto workers, the steel workers, because that was the whole perspective of the so-called radicalized people in the anti-war movement and the New Left, was you organize the so-called oppressed against those who have it made, which means they have a mortgage to pay and a car and a job. And the only thing you were going to do with that, said, was to set up a situation for fascism. The second thing we argued, as I said before, in part, is that you had to have an intellectual elite created, particularly from students, heavily on the campuses, who would understand the ideas and philosophy and epistemology with the breadth that was required to lead in a time of crisis. So we were looking for intellectuals, right? Looking for people who were willing to study and to think. And then the last thing that you could say we really pushed very hard on was that we had a sense of, let me see how I figured out to do this. The term we used was class for itself. Now, that most people's idea of their identity is what they do in their own community, their own job, their own church, perhaps their sex, you know, whatever, which is a very narrow sense of identity. Whereas this, and we called it at that time the class in itself. But what was required for society to function in the most human way for everyone, for people to be productive, for us to overcome this massive economic deficit and standard of living and so forth, was for people to have a universal identity. Today we would describe that more in the sense of agape and the sense of a creative individual acting out of love for all mankind. But it was always our polemic that acting for all mankind universally was not just for your own particular group was the only way in which you were going to be able to have a positive change in society. Now, our belief, Lynn's firm belief, was that that people could be transformed from this narrow sense of identity to a universal sense of identity. It was not only the intellectuals who would have that change, but ordinary working people could have that change in sense of identity. The guts of this idea is really what's in Shelley's In Defense of Poetry, that in periods of great ferment, people become more intelligent. They're willing to take on more ideas and broaden their sense of what they're going to do in world history. And we operated always from that firm conviction. In other words, you don't take people where they are, you take them where they have to go, and you understand that they have to move. And the fourth idea that we very much used, and Lynn really got from, as far as I know, got from a great woman in the socialist movement who was executed in 1919, Rosa Luxemburg, was the idea of a political mass strike, which is a period of history of ferment, of revolution of all kinds, where people do change more rapidly than in other periods. Basically a period of when institutions are discredited, when there's social and economic breakdown, under the right kind of leadership, people will rise to the occasion and act nobly and act on the basis for their country as a whole or for the world as a whole, in fact. She called that the political mass strike period. So from this standpoint, and very much from this idea of the strategic conjuncture, because Lynn had made his predictions about the monetary crisis earlier on, he begins this class in Marxist economics in New York City. As he says, in a sleazy loft on 14th Street, he gave numerous classes. There were, you know, anywhere from a few people to a lot of people, depending. The first one I went to wasn't until 1968, so the one I was in probably had 10 people there, just people who were floating around. Maybe like me, they weren't working because they were living off savings. I mean, they were students, bumming around to a certain degree. And he emphasized method. His class was known as a challenging, difficult class. He was probably the only person most people had ever heard that talked about epistemology. And he talked about the worldwide cup of coffee, he talked about history in broad strokes, and he talked about expanded reproduction. In other words, the need for technological progress to expand what you're producing for humanity as a whole. At the same time he was giving the class, he set up a political group. The political group was called the Committee for Independent Political Action, CIPA. And they met in a living room, right? Lynn's living room. And they worked with other independent leftists, so-called, particularly around taking Lynn's economic ideas in programmatic form to whatever fora we could get to. And this was heavily, I think you see back there, tax landlords, not people. That was the particular thrust that we boiled everything down to for the agitation purposes. Took it to budget hearings in the city, took it to Democratic Party clubs, to left groups and so forth, and said, look, You know, it's no good for you just to bellyache about the fact that your houses are falling down, or you have a budget crisis, or you have a particular problem. You've got to deal with the economic crisis. And the way to deal with the economic crisis is to construct housing, because we have a problem because there's a shortage of housing, break the monopoly. At that time in New York City, there was 1% vacancy rate. I mean, so you were really, despite rent control, which makes it better than Virginia no matter what, you nonetheless had an incredible stranglehold on the part of the landlords because of this very small vacancy rate. So the idea was to break that by taxing the speculation in the real estate market and breaking out of this crisis. Now, so it starts off with this group, and some are professionals, some are from campuses, heavily from Columbia University for some reason. And in 1967, the group also went very much onto the campuses. And some of the people who were in Lynn's class, although not particularly necessarily identified with any organization at that time, began to go onto campuses and stir things up. Take my husband, for example. He wasn't my husband yet, but I mean, he was. We were still in Columbia University School of Social Work, and he went up to the main campus in Columbia and was part of a sit-in against recruiting to the CIA on the campus. Right. So, I mean, they nearly all got kicked out of school. The only reason they didn't was, he said, because at that same time, a scandal broke in the national press that the CIA was behind the National Student Association. And this was such a scandal that they couldn't really continue with the trial on objecting to the CIA, because the CIA was exposed as a sleazy operation. So the whole thing was dropped. But anyway, they began to do things like this, go onto the campus and get things, get some agitation going. And to go into the Students for Democratic Society, which was the student organization that was going at the time, and to agitate on behalf of these kinds of programs to change the economic direction of the city in particular. So there was the tax landlords program, but then also housing construction, and then also in the transit area. Where we agitated heavily in support of transit workers' demands that their wages be increased, that the maintenance not be cut, and so forth and so on. But from the standpoint of getting them into the idea of a broader economic program, that they weren't really going to solve their problem by just agitating in this way. You're going to have to change the way the economy was working overall. And in SDS, because our people specialized in these kind of things, we formed the Labor Committee of SDS. So that's where Labor Committee came from. At the same time, as you may be aware, you should go back and read The Centerfold by Paul Gallagher if you don't remember, the West Side Tenant Union Project was set up in the fall of 1967. And this is the first thing I was involved in, which involved, on the one hand, researching the creation of fictitious capital and looting in the real estate industry, which Ed did an awful lot of work on, trying to organize people around the solution that we had to that, pulling the rug out from under the speculation, basically, with the tax. Same way we talked about the derivatives tax pulling the rug out from under the speculation. But at the same time, what we were also doing, we did similar kind of work, Leif Johnson in particular, on the bond swindles of that occurred in the Transit Authority, because he found out exactly the same kind of thing had happened in terms of transferring back and forth between the city construction of the Transit Authority and then the bondholders, and you know, the bondholders would buy it from the city, and then then they would try to sell it back, and then the city would go bankrupt, and they'd sell it back. You know, and it created this massive amount of debt, which was being reflected in the fare, and also cutbacks in the actual maintenance of the system. Same thing with the Port Authority, the Bridge and Port Authority, figuring out all the bond swindles and the way these things actually operated to the point of destroying the physical economy and raising the fares. So this is what we were doing. We were getting into mobilizing groups of students, if possible, to educate themselves on economics and to begin organizing different kinds of groups in the society around the problems of life and that were very real and that reflected what was wrong with the way the economy was going, which is the creation of this fictitious value and the looting of the physical economy. Now, so this is all going on at the same time, of course, that you've got an anti-war movement, right, 1967. 1967, you've also got riots in Newark as the black nationalist movement has been pushed forward by counterinsurgency and other kinds of agents. And then eventually in the spring of 1968, you have the murder of Martin Luther King. You have violence going on through this whole period before that, black and white violence and the housing campaign and so forth. And this really begins, and you have internationally, keep in mind, the spring of 68, you've got Czechoslovakia, the spring of 68, you have France, massive student strikes in France. You've got ferment internationally because of the conjuncture of the financial crisis, the war in Vietnam, and a whole total upheaval about what these, among the youth particularly, of and the oppressed of these countries, without any proper leadership, because to the extent there was leadership, it was, I guess some of it probably was coming from the Soviet Union, was not particularly useful. And then you had a whole purpose as well of this destabilization that just was trying to carry out the phase shift, which we've talked about, from industrial society to post-industrial society. So, I mean, a lot of the upheaval, you could say, was a deliberate destabilization and destruction. On the other hand, the ferment on the part of young people in particular, and people from these areas, was very real. People were looking for, they were in crisis, they were looking for solutions. They saw their government totally screwed up. They didn't see much of a future for themselves. They didn't want to go get killed in Vietnam. They also didn't want to be recruited by the CIA, and they didn't want to do all sorts of things. They didn't really see where they were going to have a future. So in that, Lynn decided that along with Steve Kahn, who's on the back there, the picture of the Columbia strike, and Tony Papert, that they would try to move the situation in the right direction at Columbia University. And what they did, the anarchists who were basically running the student movement at Columbia University were proposing a massive disruption in the aftermath of the killing of Martin Luther King around the middle of April. So Steve came up with an idea, and he put out something called Proposal for a Spring Offensive, which probably totally blew these guys' minds away, because for one thing, it had a plan that went all through the summer to the fall, as opposed to just for the next week or the next day or, you know. The outlook that he had was primarily that we've got to we as students can protest We can particularly, we have to protest the racism of this university. And the example of the racism of the university were myriad, but the particular one was that the university was about to expand into a black area adjacent to Columbia in order to build a gymnasium and knock down a bunch of the relatively poor but nonetheless livable housing that was in the area. So it was one of these urban removal things, you know. You're going to expand, and the landlord is going to get paid a hefty sum by the university, and you're going to eliminate housing, and no one's going to have a place to go. So the students were protesting that as racism, and along with racist practices on the campus and the killing of King and so forth and so on. So Steve and Tony, Steve comes into this thing with the proposal of the offensive, and he says, okay, this is fine and good. You know, I believe at this point already a number of students were being disciplined for what they had done prior in some other activity on the campus. And they were up for suspension. Right? So there was also going to be action about that. What Steve was arguing against was the idea of just sort of bullying in and taking over a library or a building or something like that as an exemplary action. He said, no, if we're going to do something here, we have to unite with the community, with these people who live in the ghetto, and then with trade unions, and then with other groups throughout the city for an actual solution to to this crisis. And in fact, he was talking about moving into that area, which they were going to expand into, and building something for the community. I can't see exactly what that is. Actually halting construction of the gym that the university was going to do, and beginning to get a broadly representative group of people from the whole city together to demand housing construction, to demand an improvement in the living standards for everybody. So for a short period of time, Steve and Tony's proposal carried the day. You know, they were succeeded in getting the students to try to expand off the campus. It wasn't going to be a student revolt. It was going to be students in the service of the community as a whole and the city as a whole and implicitly the world as a whole. Now, also linking in demands of the cafeteria workers for better living standards and so forth and so on. And the idea was, as Lynn had taught in terms of this idea of expanding people's consciousness of who they were and of a mass strike ferment, was to constantly be expanding. That if you were going to have an action on the campus, if it wasn't constantly expanding and bringing in new people and kinds of people, that it was going to collapse, sort of like an economy. If it doesn't expand technologically, it's eventually going to collapse, and that this was the same kind of thing. So it worked for a while. I wasn't in this very much. I was, I think, working at the time. But there were marches down to join with the anti-war movement. There were marches in the area on housing and so forth. Fairly big marches. And they involved not just students, but students and ghetto youth and other people from trade unions and so forth that we could manage to bring in. Now, at a certain point, it stopped, this expansion. And the reason it stopped was, on the one hand, there were some provocateurs sent in there from the Ford Foundation, from the CIA or FBI, I don't know which. In fact, at the Columbia strike, the FBI carried out its first COINTELPRO operation against us. Then put out a leaflet attacking Tony Papert in the name of something called the mouse crap, or I don't know. But that was the first time that they intervened to try to isolate us from the entire group. And they also sent in certain black provocateurs, saying, you know, what is this? What are we worrying about the community for? We should worry about black student rights on campus. And it, the whole thing split up eventually due to operations into one group which just wanted to restructure the university, another group that just wanted blacks to be the heads of the student movement and get more rights on the campus, and another group that were anarchists. They wanted to go in and trash the library, right? So this was eventually something of a losing battle for us, but in the course of it, we did manage to pull together a labor committee group, a broader labor committee grouping, about 50 people, in May of 1968, which is really when I joined, and to bring Lynn onto the campus to teach, massive groups of people on economics, and to build a core of, and through who knew about our method of approach to the international crisis, not just a crisis on Columbia. So while the regular student movement, the Mark Rudds and the others, the anarchists and Ford Foundations and other types, were pushing that the follow-up to the movement after it had been crushed would be that there would be radical action projects formed from this. The whole thing would break up into a woman's radical action project and a black's radical action project and a lesbian's radical act, you know, and so forth, that would do things over the summer. We agitated for educationals over the summer, saying everybody had to learn from the experience that they'd been in, learn about economy, learn about how political formations work, so that when we came back in the fall, we could do something actually useful to expand the movement and improve the situation. So, I mean, we didn't get a whole lot of people, but we did bring some around in that process, myself included. And at that point, there was a public institution, the SDS Labor Committee, which met, I guess, almost at that particular time. We began a publication, our first newspaper, Solidarity, which was one side English, the other side Spanish, and was particularly aimed at going, at linking up students with workers in the garment center. Because our idea, because in the garment center, you had a situation of the poorest workers in the city, particularly black and Hispanic. They were very much kept in a plantation-type situation against the white craft workers in the garment center, so they were constantly at each other's throats. And these people in the lower echelons who were pushing around racks of garments from one sweatshop to another were the sense of what the future of a large portion of the world was going to be unless we changed the way the economy was organized. So we said to these students, you know, you can't be concerned about, you know, whether you have power on your university campus. You've got to be concerned about the fate of the ordinary working person in this country. In fact, you've got to improve the situation for the worst off people in the city. So you go to a lie and go into the garment center. We agitated with these guys to go down and help us agitate and sell newspapers, give away newspapers. We didn't even try to sell them at that point in the garment center. So that began in June 1968. At the same time, we established our first journal, which was The Campaigner. That was a monthly magazine of theoretical articles circulating to people around us to get out our ideas, particularly attacking the misconceptions on economy and social processes and that were extant, and other left groups too, that were extant in the anti-war movement and other movements at that point. Now, history and so forth. Now, I've tried, I haven't found the first issue of the Campaigner. The issue that you have that I Xeroxed for you, number four, is number four, the New Left, Local Control, and Fascism. There were two, there were three before that. One, two of them I know had an article attacking local trade union organizing as the guts of revolutionizing society. The first one, I'm not actually sure. I'm sure Lynn remembers, but most other old-timers that I've managed to talk to tonight do not remember exactly which what it was. But we started it right away, and it was extremely important to us to circulate this kind of material. And over the summer, we continued to meet, and the next intervention we determined to have was into the New York City teacher strike, because the follow-up to Columbia by the provocateurs and Ford Foundation and so forth, which succeeded in splitting apart that movement on racial lines, was to use the racial polarization against one of the major trade unions in the city, which was the teachers' union. And they were trying to, and they succeeded in recruiting the two other major radical groups, right, the Communist Party and the Socialist Workers' Party, to side with the black community, oppressed community, against the teachers' union for local control of schools. Right. Now, it's very, and I gave you this article because it's absolutely critical to everything that's happened since that time, and in terms of our own approach to this local organizing question. And we saw our role as stopping race riots in this situation, but also to identify the process by which you were going to see the so-called left turned into outright fascist mobs, because that's what was going on. And from that standpoint, the New Left, Local Control, and Fascism article is written, going back to the history of Mussolini, the history of the way fascism has been developed by a splintering and fragmentation of the population into these local interest groups fighting each other, and then fascism from a, you know, and then the arbiter, the authority coming in from above to keep order as the police state, which is sort of the sociology of it, although not the economics of it, which is also part of the argument, but not the critical part of the argument. The critical part on economics that we argued with these guys was, look, the reason the Ford Foundation and the bankers want a community control fight between the black community and the trade unions is because they want to cut the budget. And what better way for them to cut the budget than to have you guys not fighting for an increase in the school budget, but fighting each other over who's going to control the diminishing returns that are coming in from the city as a whole. And we were very successful in this, in the sense that we got out a lot of material, and we embarrassed some of these left groups out of carrying out their full program. Very little violence actually did. We went to the people in the black community to tell them how they were being used. We went to the trade union, we went to the AFT, we went to all the groups that were being mobilized as shock troops around it. And we were extremely successful in that way. And from that time, you know, when you combine what happened at the Columbia strike and what happened there, McGeorge Bundy is an enemy of Lynn's and ours for life. Right? No question about it, because we screwed up the game. And we put it directly on the Ford Foundation for what they were actually doing. Actually, at the time, I believe Ed was working at the Ford Foundation, one of the projects, so he was aware on the inside, too, that he had a grant there And so he was had an insider's view also of how the Ford Foundation was trying to run this, and that didn't make them too happy either. So that's where we cut our teeth, so to speak. Now, at the same time, of course, from that 1968 period forward, Columbia was a big deal, right, in terms of the student and national anti-war movement. New York was a place where a lot of people were, in that period of college age, were in and out of. And we were constantly also intervening into anti-war activities, into SDS meetings, and so forth, not necessarily just on the East Coast, sometimes in the Midwest, you know, to get the word out, to spread our intellectual activity, to express the idea of a transitional program out of this decay of the way the capitalist system was organized. Now, Lynn was in constant fights with the leading economic gurus of the left, who basically had this line that the working class was consuming too much, and also that that it was big corporations that were the problem, not the banks. I mean, there were a whole lot of incredibly stupid things that they were organizing around, all of which were basically justifications for the kind of local trade union organizing or local community organizing, constituency organizing that they were carrying out, which would do nothing but set people up in a period of crisis to be played against each other and to be destroyed. So at the same time, we were handing out not only the campaigner, but Lynn had written another document called The Third Stage of Imperialism, which was done particularly handed out at anti-war rallies. This was unsold, actually. We sold this one because I think we paid to have it produced, as opposed to the campaigners, which were produced by my husband in various printing presses that were either in public places or eventually in his basement. Lynn was also very big on this. He knew all about how to run these presses. So we produced them ourselves. But the Third Stage of Imperialism pamphlet of Lynn's was also something we got out very widely. And this was basically an evaluation of the strategic conjunctural crisis on the economy, why the war was going on in Vietnam from an economic perspective, and the crisis of that the system was in at that point, and the approach of international reconstruction that was required. The second organization we ended up forming was in Philadelphia. That was the Second Labor Committee. It was involved also in coming out of a strike situation at Temple University, although most of the people who joined were from Swarthmore College. And then from there is, you know, we continue to expand nationally. The Labor Committee was formed as a national organization. It was an SDS Labor Committee, a New York SDS Labor Committee, and a Philadelphia SDS Labor Committee. And then in January 1969, it became the National Caucus of Labor Committees. Caucus because it was still part of SDS. Now, not that SDS wanted us. SDS didn't want us at all. But because of the credentials which we had through the Columbia strike in particular, they couldn't really get rid of us. So we were there. It's like us in the Democratic Party today, excuse me. To a certain degree, it reminds me. I mean, you go to the meeting and you argue the perspective that they have to take, all right? And most people totally disagree with you. But gradually, a few here and there would come along, you know, and we were growing small, but we were growing. And we knew that eventually the SDS was going to collapse because it was so rotten in terms of any ideas or perspective of what they were going to do. It was you know, it was breaking in the way that things had broken apart on Columbia. You know, the black nationalists, the radical lesbians, the student movement, and so forth. The anarchists, the Weathermen, which came out of SDS. Right? So these, so we saw that that was happening, and we knew eventually we were going to be kicked out of it. The other part of the student movement, of course, would just go straight basically into the liberal wing of the Democratic Party and the New Left in the anti-war movement. But we kept going to all the meetings and proposing extensive resolutions about the world economic crisis, you know, how this had come about and what needed to be done and how people had to work for a program of international reconstruction, socialist reconstruction. We called it that. This meant spending all this money to improve the conditions of life of people in below the Tropic of Cancer. It involved a housing program, a jobs program, and so forth and so on. So, and these guys would simply, would tend to go crazy because their whole idea was that you had to radically change your consciousness to understand the oppressed, or you had to understand women's problems, or you had to understand, you couldn't understand workers' problems unless you were in a factory, after all. I mean, how could you understand someone's problem if you hadn't been through that experience? So, you know, you're constantly arguing with people as to why they could have gone through it, but they haven't learned a damn thing about it because they don't know history, they don't know economics, they don't know how the world fits together and what has to be done. So that's what we were doing all the time. And eventually, in, I think, June of 1969, we were kicked out of SDS. Which we didn't really care a lot about. I mean, we'd been there long enough to get whomever we thought was viable from that milieu. And we wanted to have an orientation to the population more generally anyway, and to the major left organizations that still had a position within the trade union movement in particular, which were the Communist Party and the Socialist Workers Party. So at that point, when we were kicked out, spring of 69, I mean, June of 69, we were still putting out the newspaper heavily on economic crises, rent situation, transit situation. We had a separate paper in Philadelphia called Crisis, and a paper in New York was called Solidarity. And the economic crisis, of course, was accelerating in this period a great deal. Now, what happened in 69 as well, however, while we had had established ourselves in Philadelphia and New York, is that we had our first explicit action against us by the cops. There was a bomb plot frame-up of us in Philadelphia. The two leaders from down there were arrested by the local Red Squad. It said they found a bomb under their refrigerator and then and put on trial for potential terrorism. Now, this was a total, I mean, they planted the bomb and then they took the bomb out. So this created a new situation for us. I mean, not that we hadn't been in a fight at Columbia with police agents. We certainly had, and you saw police agents all over the place. But, you know, this was our first legal attack in that, other than being picked up at a demonstration. And it created, now as far as we know, this was a local police Red Squad operation. Although, my husband points out to me, we defeated the case by when we filed a federal motion to disclose if there had been wiretaps on our phones. And they refuse to divulge the information as to whether they had been or not, and therefore the case was dropped. Now, that would lead one to believe that perhaps the federal government was involved in this, although we have never gotten anything on Freedom of Information Act or anything else that would have indicated that. But this really changed our situation. I mean, we had these two guys who were facing a lot of time by the Red Squad down there. And we formed an international, a national commission to defend them. I mean, the major thing I remember about this case is I got a $5,000 check from Noam Chomsky as part of our defense. I mean, this was a cause, right? Because the head of the Red Squad in Philadelphia was internationally known for beating up blacks on the front page. You know, he's been pictures of him beating up blacks on the front page, and he was known as a nasty guy. So we established a big commission and took legal action and eventually managed to beat the thing. But the process of this happening, the members who were under direct assault like that got scared. I mean, all of a sudden it became clear that this wasn't going to be some debating society and lots of fun, right? I mean, you were putting yourself in harm's way. So that affected a whole layer of the people. I mean, you recall how Lynn has discussed the anti-war student movement from this period. You had a lot of scared bunnies who basically didn't have a whole lot of morality, but were in this movement because they didn't want to go to Vietnam, right? So numbers of these people had some intellectual quality, were attracted by Lynn's ideas, were attracted by us, but when it became serious, they weren't quite sure what they wanted to do. And you had the tremendous sense of opportunism that came to people under these circumstances. And the fact that we did get some people on this commission level, you had a grouping of people in the Labor Committee who began to look to find friends in the most impossible places. They wanted to make compromises all over the place in order to submerge ourselves in a larger movement so that we wouldn't be attacked in this way. It was, you know, very opportunist. And it showed itself in a couple ways. It didn't show itself explicitly. It was not the case that these people came out and said, well, we should dissolve ourselves into this group. But it was that they would make arguments for tactical campaigns that were obviously designed to try to mend fences with people who were in many cases on the other side. So, for example, they wanted us to merge in with the ecology movement, you know, in one way or another. Now, that's not quite as crazy as you might think, because, I mean, Lynn had very explicitly defined ecology in a scientific way, saying that when you destroy something in the environment, you should call it a cost of production, and you should use technology to restore the environment to a state of equipotential so that it can continue to be productive and useful. I mean, that's a real sense of using up capital of nature. You replace it, right, or improve it after you've used it up. So we had a scientific sense of ecology. So it's not totally crazy that they would say we should work with the ecology movement. But you don't work with the ecology movement without taking on the fundamental axioms that they're coming from, which were overconsumptionism. I mean, most of the people in the ecology movement were coming at it from the standpoint not of restoring nature to so it can be more productive for more people in a greater progress. They were approaching it from the standpoint that you have all these fat, dumb workers in the United States who are eating too much and driving too many cars and, you know, basically looting the world's resources, and that you had to mobilize poor people to take things away from the richer people so that, and at the same time, get rid of this polluting industry. So that was one way it happened. Another way that that this opportunism showed itself was wanting to form a broad anti-repression coalition. Well, you know, we've had some experience with that these days after Lynn went to jail, because you don't want to, there are very good reasons not to ally with every case of people who are being gone after by the federal government, because some of them should be being gone after by the federal government. You're going to find yourself in bed with every terrorist in the world. You know, if that's the basis, if that's the principle on which you define your organization. So this was, and it was a scary situation, believe me. I mean, it was scary because of the police repression. It was scary because the country was polarizing, not all, you know, in the pro-war, anti-war, black, white, employed, unemployed. You know, it was a mess. So, and our guys were very much under attack. Now, and we do know, although not directly connected to the arrest, we did get an FOIA later that showed that there were COINTELPRO operations against our Philadelphia operation in an election that we also were involved in down there. So this is, we're talking 1969, 1970. What's happening in 1969, 1970? What's happening is that kind of polarization. What's happening is an intensified economic crisis. Penn Central bankruptcy is in the spring or June of 1970. That's a big shock to, in the financial side. You have had the pound crisis. You've had financial shocks going on the currency markets as well. And the and you have a growing anti-war movement, which is more and more being taken over by the liberal wing of the Democratic Party, the total post-industrial side of things, the McGovern types. And at the same time, you have a splintering into anarchism and so forth and so on. And we're trying to build what we call a cadre organization of intellectuals to say, how are we going to deal with this intensified crisis? Who's going to train themselves to be able to understand what actually should be done, not only in this country, but on a global scale. Now, in 1970, so we've expanded to Baltimore, I believe, by this time. So we have New York, we have Baltimore, we have Philadelphia. We are putting out the newspaper. In May of 1970, we combined the two newspapers to New Solidarity. We had lots of jokes at the time. Would it be Crawlidarity, or, you know, would it? How would we combine crisis and solidarity? And we ended up making it New Solidarity. Actually had nothing to do with the UAW, despite what they thought at a later time. And I think the first issue, when I show you the slideshow, you'll see what the first issue was. But, you know, we had a heavy emphasis on getting the newspaper out. What's also happening in this time is, of course, that Lynn is corresponding internationally as well with people in various groups. He meets, the entree internationally, as far as I know, actually is through Nick and Kostas Kalimchis, who were students in New York and then went back into Europe to do some political work there. And through that, Lynn got contacts and with a whole number of people and began circulating his material and so forth to pull together a network internationally. But we were beginning to look at the international side of this operation. And Lynn is very much looking at the fact that we've got to get ourselves into the working population and that we've got to address the accelerating financial aspect of the crisis. He's looking for increased labor activity, which did in fact occur. Began occurring at that time. There's a postal strike, you know, there were other kinds of labor activity like that, which we would tend to go into from the standpoint of what's the overall program of change of the economy that's required to solve this. You're not going to solve it on your own. You're going to have to solve it in a much broader way. And two things were what we went back, it was in this period we went back and did a lot of work on the 30s and what was useful and what was not useful during the 30s as far as isolated strikes that would get crushed to strikes that would expand to alliances with the unemployed, to alliances on a much broader scale with the with other industries, trade unions. In August of 1970, Lynn writes his first U.S. Reconstruction Program. And that's what you see on the back there. That's How to Lick a Depression in a Single Day. I've gone through that a couple times in conference presentations. And that's the major thing that you should look at in that socialism or fascism pamphlet that I handed out to you. Because at the end of that is the Reconstruction Program, which did not come out in 1971 after the dollar crisis. It came out more than a year before, in August of 1970, basically after the Penn Central crisis, which created a shock in that way. Now, what did this thing do? I mean, this is a 7-point program, which is really, you know, just, which talks, number one, about bankruptcy reorganization. I mean, on the one hand, you can say, you can be really glad that we've been so consistent for 26 years. On the other hand, you're really convinced with how dumb people are in this country that they haven't picked up this idea all this time. But the first aspect of the program is regional transportation upgrade between cities. Second part is national transportation upgrade, which is goods, you know, freight. The third is nuclear energy. The fourth is anti-pollution activity from the standpoint that I was talking about before. The fourth is electronic data processing to reduce administration. The sixth is upgrading the technologies of all industries, like eliminating backbreaking work in the garment center and other kinds of assembly line work and so forth. And the seventh was infrastructure. Infrastructure for the people in particular who lived in the Tropic of Cancer, where there was a 25, I don't know whether we said 2 billion or 3 billion people who lived in that south undeveloped sector of the world that had a $25 trillion deficit in the infrastructure that was required. They weren't, you know, they weren't living. So that was the, from that time forward, that was the program that we were agitating for. And we would go into every labor situation, as well as student situation, to say, this is the program that you have to master. And okay, people aren't ready. They'll say, well, people aren't ready for this. It's too broad, it's too big, right? Well, people have got to become ready for this, and those of you who, and you have to study why they have to become ready for this, come to this class, so forth and so on. Shortly after this, we also began certain projects to try to put people into social formations that would permit them to understand better why you needed to have employed ally with unemployed, blacks with whites, so forth and so on. Particularly, this was around strikes in Baltimore. And in Baltimore, there was a strike in September of 1970, I believe, called the Schmidt Bakery Strike. Now, I think I eat Schmidt today, so I think that place is still there. But these workers went on strike, and I don't know what it was all about. It really doesn't matter so much. But we were in touch with them, and we were telling them what was the global situation on the economy and what needed to be done. And we were saying, well, you know, we're willing, we think your demands are just, but we can tell you that under this kind of economic situation, you're not going to get anywhere by yourself. You're going to have to ally with people in other unions, with the unemployed, into what we called at that time a cross-union caucus in order to get anywhere. You're going to have to expand the strike, similar to the Columbia University situation. You're going to have to expand it around demands that are in the interest, economic interest, of everybody in the area. For example, you know, we'd never go into a situation which would say that, you know, one group of workers should get jobs at the expense of another group of workers, or, you know, get an increase in pay at the expense of another one, like the kind of thing that happens now, where they might go on strike and or have a protest in Baltimore against a ship contract going to Norfolk, because there's only one ship going to be built, so they're fighting with each other as to who's going to get the ship contract. So we would say, well, there should be two ships built, or, you know, there should be other kinds of ships built, and everybody should be employed, and the following measures should be taken to pay for it. And the measures should be taxation of bankers in one form or another. So we began to do this in Baltimore. It was extremely successful, because at that, unlike today, where there's a parody of this in the so-called Rainbow Coalition, right, where they pulled together civil rights movement people with union people and Jesse Jackson and, you know, the whole group of hustlers. At that time, this was not the general mode of organizing at all. Everybody was intensifying their own struggle in their own particular area for themselves. So we are bringing in unemployed and bringing in people from other unions to support the Schmidt Bakery strike was a new social phenomenon. And it was actually, I don't know if we won the strike. I think we did. I mean, I think they won the strike because unexpectedly the thing expanded instead of narrowing down. So that's what was going on during this period, and the along with a continuous fight by Lynn and by some of the rest of us to try to get the students who were our core of organization to see that this is what they had to do, that they had to take on the task of trying to explain economy and get some actual hard work done of organizing working people who were obviously not willing to sit around and bullshit for hours in quite the same way that students were, and that were, you know, posed all sorts of different problems than they had been used to in organizing in the anti-war movement and so forth and so on. We also had to take on in the course of this an emerging counterculture problem that was in our own ranks. Some of the people who had been recruited in Philadelphia, for example, had spread up to Cornell, because one of the guys in Philadelphia had a brother at Cornell, so up in Ithaca. And we found them smoking some marijuana, and, you know, this was a big deal, and we had to get rid of them, or discipline them, and, you know, but there was a lot of game playing going on at the same time on the counterculture question. Then there were this fear-generated reaction coming from people in Philadelphia who were under assault by the authorities and were looking for a way out, you know, a broader movement that was going to give us a way out without having to stick to the principles that we have. Ultimately, in the 19, under the pressure of the assault, the probably some promises by people like Noam Chomsky, the pressure to get into working class organizing, we had a growing split in the organization, our first split. Now, unfortunately, I should have looked up these internal documents because they're really hilarious, but because Lynn would make fun of them very of the softies in a very funny way. We called them the Bavarians because they acted like trolls, some of the leaders of this particular group. And those of us on the other side called ourselves the positive political tendency. So you can tell we were a lot more stodgy. But anyway, but Lynn made up for all that by writing humorous internal documents to attack them. And we had big fights over, at that point, the editorials in the Campaigner magazine were done by actually an editorial board, a totally unworkable situation, of course. And there was a huge fight where the Campaigner didn't come out for 3 months because there was, couldn't be agreement over the editorial and the editor, you know, and so forth and so on. So it was hilarious. But ultimately, in January of 1971, we had a showdown. And the Lynn put forward a tasks and perspectives document, which he used to do regularly when we had conferences. Now, and at the conclusion, in voting up that tasks and perspectives document, the people who lost walked out, which, as I said, was about 80 out of 200 people. And we began the year of 1971 with about 120 people. Now, interestingly enough, that tasks and perspective document is published in a book. I had forgotten all about this. Pat Salisbury's former husband, a guy named Kenneth Dolbert, was a sociology professor, obviously in leftist circles, in Seattle, Washington. And we were in touch with her and with him. And he did a book called Institutions, Policies, and Goals: A Reader in American Politics, which is not actually, was not published until 1973, but a lot of this stuff comes from earlier than that. And this has in it The Threat of World Depression by Lynn Marcus. It has an article by myself that I'd totally forgotten about called The Crisis of the Cities. And it has our tasks and perspectives document from 1971 that Lynn had presented to. So you can tell this is no raving radical document from the standpoint of an academic. It really is not. And it was called Strategies for Socialism, Tasks and Perspectives, but it basically goes into the failure of every other group to deal with the economic crisis and social crisis of the period, particularly at big attacks on the Socialist Workers' Party and the Communist Party. And then it says the following: as we stated in the September 1970 resolution, the function of tasks and perspectives resolutions for socialist organizations flows from the problem of the role of the single socialist individual in history, the individual in history. Unless one has a conception of how one is intervening or can intervene as an individual to alter the course of human history, then the idea of socialist politics or tasks and perspectives resolutions would be self-socializing idiocy. Sounds like Lynn, right? And then he goes on to say the question of individual existence is not biological existence, it's a question of your identity. What the individual must do, transforming people's consciousness or sense of identity, then the political mass strike, primitive accumulation, how the new left is collapsing and why, problem of the labor movement, and then the strike support and the emergency reconstruction program of what is required. And that basically is it. And then it comes down to what the immediate tasks are. The immediate tasks are education, building these cross-union caucuses, increasing the frequency and circulation of the newspaper, a lot more outreach, what we would call outreach today, open up labor committee locals in the industrial heartland, bring every politically significant strike support effort into national focus for national work, because we never wanted these things to be done just in one area. I mean, they had expanded in Baltimore to win, but we did then what we do now, which is if you have a local fight, you try to get support from, well, we couldn't do it all over the world there, but at least then, because we didn't have organization all over the world, but all over the country, you know, from Boston, from Chicago, from Seattle, and so forth. Trying to get other groups to work on the tasks that we were involved in. Developed the membership as a centralized, task-oriented organization respecting tactical undertakings and the quality of the deliberative process. Increased the scope and depth of coverage of in New Solidarity in the Campaigner. And develop a sustained and scholarly program of educating workers and others in the history of the socialist movement, labor movement, and so forth. So, heavily talking about education all the way through and the improvement of the writing that we would be doing in our publications. What? 1971. What? Yeah, I can pass this around. So, that's basically where I want to take it today. 1971, it's our first split. We are basically out of the student movement. We're out of the New Left movement. We're looking at the, we have begun to get our feet wet with trade unions and broader formations in the society. We are up against various competitors, obviously, as far as the radical mood that was spreading, particularly those in the Communist Party and the Socialist Workers Party, who had been what we used to call that burrowing from within or boring from within for a long, long time in these groups. And, you know, we were 120 people who'd been through a certain amount of a fight and a certain amount of education with a certain sense that we were going to determine what was going to happen in this country. It's going to be a big, at least this country, if not beyond. So that's it, what I have for now. Do you have any questions?
Who's Noam Chomsky?
He is a linguistician whom Lynn has virulently attacked from MIT? MIT, yeah. Boston, MIT. He's one of the artificial intelligence gurus, studied linguistics, which he developed with linguistics. And in that sense, he was very much of an evil influence intellectually, and he was in the liberal mafia from the stand of a McGeorge Bundy type of politics. But these guys were very much the people who were mobilizing at that point. As you know, McGeorge Bundy organized the war and then he organized the anti-war. So they were very much that grouping was very much in the anti-war movement.
If you mean good, say bad variety, or was he, you know, if you want
to... No, he was an academic who was against the war. There was a very broad sentiment of academics against the war. They were against it, you know, because some of them because they thought there was nothing wrong with communism, others because it was killing people, others because they don't, you know, which is true enough for no reason. Others because they were against militarism, per se.
What does he have to do with linguistics?
That was his field of study. He was a professor.
He's still publishing that.
I think he's still around. He is a, like Paul Samuelson, I don't know that he ever won a Nobel Prize, but he could have. You know, he's an academician in the field of linguistics, but he was also in radical politics. We run into these guys like around the Iranian Revolution in 1979. There were some leading academics, like a fellow by the name of Peter Falk from, I think Peter Falk, maybe, Richard Falk. No, Peter Falk's the actor. Richard Falk from Princeton, who was very active in supporting the Iranian Revolution. But that's not his field of study. He's just... That's his field. In ideas, his politics were coherent with that. But his
so,
main...
Once in a while at the table, I mean, people come up and say, you know, they're big on Noam Chomsky. And they're not very good. It never seems to start, it never seems to go anywhere. I never really know too much about Noam Chomsky, but he's still evidently active in publishing and he has some kind of following. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's an academic institution of a school of linguistics, and it's the way the Wiener and the art and von Neumann, right? I mean, these guys established certain kinds of modern schools of so-called thought, which. But the significance of him doing that with us is that, basically, we would tend to be totally on the opposite sides, but. It is significant in our background that we have had, that there have been certain periods where we've been under attack by state institutions where people have come to our defense. I think it's important to know that. I mean, we've always approached it in a very similar way of trying to pull together political support on a principled basis. We did it then, we did it later. You know, after the Chris White incident, you know, we did it around the federal cases. But it tells you something also to the extent that you tend to think of us as a very isolated group. To the extent that anyone thinks of us as an isolated group, it's just not true, right? Our history and how much we've affected, how many people we've affected with our ideas and personally over the past 26, you know, almost 30 years now, is enormous, right? So that underneath, now, and all of it, of course, has not been peaches and cream, right? There have been an awful lot of fights, which we've been in with people. But I think it's important to know that this kind of activity went on. It's also important to know that we were under attack by the government, you know, from 1968 forward. Right.
When did that come in?
That came in later. It came in 74. But at this point, we were dealing with the FBI and the Ford Foundation and their spin-offs in the Black Nationalist Movement, in the Anarchist Movement, and so forth and so on, who attacked us from the side, right? They attacked us from the side, from the top. We were attacked by the FBI in particular. And I think very early on, by the time of 1971, I think the whole bunch of us at the top were on the list to be rounded up if there were a national emergency in the United States. Oh, no, I was. Of course, they were pretty incompetent. They said I had brown eyes, so forth. But you know, this—we were by simply dint of our intellectual uniqueness and power, and the Columbia strike, right? And what we did with George Bundy in the teacher strike. you know, we were very, very well known, you know, as the people who were totally different. And at some point, probably, I don't know whether it's before 71 or not, but as I mentioned in the conference presentation, you know, we were attacking this kind of polarizing organizing constantly, you know, of whites against blacks, suburbanites against urban, you know, unemployed against employed, and so forth. And, you know, Paul Gallagher and Ed wrote this article called Sharing the Poverty, which attacked the local control strategy as a government, we said CIA counterinsurgency strategy. In fact, we blamed the Kennedy machine for a lot of it, and I'm sure they were involved. After all, Bobby Kennedy and these guys were all heavily involved in the in that kind of stuff against the Teamsters and all sorts of things. So they wrote this article. It was published in a national anti-war journal. It was, besides our own publications. Our own publication size, of course, was relatively small, although we used to print 50,000 solidarities in New York City per week, you know, to go out and give away, get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, go down to the Garment Center when to organize working people. I mean, we weren't interested in going to shopping malls because there were fewer then, but, you know, we got up to hit people when they were going to work.
When did Kissinger start attacking us?
Later than this, 1973-74.
About the same time the ADL started.
Yes. Yes, but I should, it's important to know the actual context, and I'll get into that next time around.
By 1971, how well was the labor communist spread in Europe?
Not hardly at all, hardly at all. Just a little bit of, as I said, we had two Greek contacts here who went to a class of Mr. LaRouche's, and then they went back to Europe to run a Greek magazine. And they were meeting with people in the anti-war movement and left circles there. And that was the way in which Mr. LaRouche's ideas began to circulate. And then eventually classes were held to recruit. But we didn't form a European labor committee until 73, really. 1972-73. Although we began to bring some people over to our conferences a little earlier than that. For example, there was a whole network of people who were draft dodgers who came over, who were able to come back, I guess, at that point, or figured out some way to come back. And, you know, one of those people ended up being fingered by a police agent and going to jail for being a draft dodger. Others people's, you know, just were able to go ahead and have no problem. I don't really know the history of everybody to know why some people had a, you know, some people never had a problem. But, so we didn't really have an organization until 72, 73. Same thing for Latin America. 1972, 73 is when we begin to expand, and that's from the United States, of having people in New York who had international connections, so to speak, and having them, or, you know, people in other universities with international connections who spread the word as to who we were, and then eventually brought people into classes and to New York many times to meet with Lynn or to have classes here, have discussions. Any other questions?
One of the most annoying things often when Lynn writes something or speaks is that he often assumes that people have been around since the 60s. And for instance, Mike, one of the things he often refers to that is often lost on me as a whole period around Detroit and so forth. But that's just to lead up to saying that the point that you raised early on, that there was a difference between LaRouche and the Marxists around the idea that ideas are more important than material factors. It may be incorrect to assume that people are knowledgeable about those tenets of Marxism, such as that, and particularly given the fact that this is one of the major slanders is that LaRouche was first far-left Marxist and all that. I think it's a crucial differentiation because it goes right to the heart of the epistemology to actually, if you care to elaborate on this whole Marxist idea and then contrast it to LaRouche.
You'll see it in part in the writings that you see, right? Because Lynn is writing within a left milieu in both of these documents which you have, and he's attacking very hard the materialist idea of history. I have to admit, I was never a leftist before I met my husband. And numbers of people who did join us had been in left groups, Progressive Labor Party, which was a Maoist group, or they were real nuts. I think that those who didn't leave Progressive Labor Party ended up in the Hare Krishna or something. I don't know. I mean, they were really, they were far out. That's the major group, actually. But there were, we tried to recruit some people from the Communist Party and Socialist Workers Party and other left. I mean, we certainly intervened enough into all these milieus. And Lynn used to go to what was called Socialist Scholars Conferences, of all things, where he would present papers about the history of how the Soviet Union sold out the workers' movement somewhere, or things on economy, fights over what creates value in the economy, attacks on this idea that corporations are self-sufficient as opposed to being run by the banking system and so forth, the under-consumptionism idea and so forth. So the basic, what was going on, as I said, in the left was that they dealt with Marxism like a religion, right? In the bad sense of dogma. They had a dogma that the working class is everything, although they were shifting. So therefore, whatever the working class thinks it wants is what you have to be for. I mean, there's not really a lawfulness to the universe in the need for expanded production. It's, what they want. Although, as I say, this was changing and they were looking for other constituencies because the workers in the United States were not really your most radical bunch, right? I mean, they were supporting the war in Vietnam, for example, which was not in the same outlook. So they were looking for other radicalized people. The idea was that the more impoverished you were, the more you had to be, that would make you revolutionary conscious. Your objective circumstance would give you what would be called revolutionary consciousness, as opposed to having to have the right idea with which to make the necessary change. One thing that very much reminds me of, which I'm closer to than I am to the 60s actually, is that if you recall, if you've read the material on Sun Yat-sen, I don't know if you have, his fight with the communists. I think he was also in a united front with the communists when he formed the republic in 1911. But they had a theory that said action first and the ideas come later. You know, what's hard, they said, is action. The ideas are simple. He said, no, you first have to have the right idea. And then action is, you know, possible in the right direction. It's very similar between us and the rest of these groups. What else can I say? I mean, the question of defense of the Soviet Union really wasn't a big deal. I mean, that was not a dividing line issue. The dividing line issues were much more the question of local constituencies, that they would defend trade unions. I mean, they couldn't conceive of this idea, which seems so obvious, of developing an economic program that would cross social barriers. It was demand as much as possible for these workers in this factory, and then the unemployed should demand as much as they should demand. And even though that comes into conflict, you don't present the solution. I mean, they would very much get upset with Lynn because they would say, you're presenting the solution to the capitalists. What are you doing that for? They're the enemy, right? We just want to intensify the struggle of the oppressed, but you're providing the solution. And, you know, which is like being a class traitor. And Lynn would say, but the idea is to solve the crisis that we have. And we're trying to prepare working people to participate in running the government. And if they're going to do that, they have to know what the program for reconstruction in the government would be. And it has to be in the interest of everybody, not one group against another. So that, for sure, was one of the major areas that it comes back to me. You know, they would basically say, you know, you're helping the capitalists. You're telling them. In other words, you're an intellectual. You're an intellectual. You know about economics. That's not the business of workers to know about economics. The business of workers is to fight for, you know, what they've produced and the right receipts for what they've produced.
Class struggle.
Yeah.
Eternal.
It's more little rebellions, you know, you just fight this little rebellion here and another one.
It'll all add up. It's sort of like Adam Smith, right? If you start a fight, if you have every factory start a fight with its own employers, eventually it'll all add up to making a revolution, right? And, you know, because of the invisible hand, I guess. I don't know. I mean, So to the extent that we would say, no, you've got to change the way people are thinking, and say, no, you know, not just radicalize them, you've got to change the way people are thinking. And then the other major thing was this post-industrial idea, this idea that you have a fixed amount of wealth and you're just going to redistribute it, right? As opposed to fighting for science and technology. I mean, they never really thought of, I mean, these guys that we, in these Communist Party and Socialist Workers' Party, just couldn't really think about that. But I'm telling you, eventually what they did is they all joined the Democratic Party. So what their actual thoughts are very similar to what you think of the liberal Democrats today, but with a little bit more of a pro-working class orientation than some would have. I mean, that's what they actually represented. I'm trying to think if I can think of another example of what difference the materialism made, but certainly that difference on thinking about the economy, and then also thinking about how people think. When we gave classes to intellectuals about, well, how people think. They're not biologically determined. You're not just an individual. What you develop your sense of identity in relationship to a family, in relationship. Lynn always measured the economy in terms of family households. So they would go wild at talking about how people think, because why should you get involved in that? I mean, their view is that you just have to get people angry, you know, they have to be angry enough and fight for what belongs to them. And that somehow that would result in increased members of their membership in their organization, and eventually the leadership of their parties would be vaulted into political control at one point or another. Another major thing, although I think this came later, that Lynn leveled as an attack on the other major parties in an organizational form, is called an attack on centrism. Some of you may have heard of this because I think Dennis Speed was promoting this particular publication of Lynn's, which is quite relevant to us today, because what he's talking about in there is the degeneration of groups that began with a cause. It might not have been the cause may not have had the intellectual depth that it should have had, but they began, I mean, many of these people, maybe not the organizations, but the people began with a cause that they wanted to fight for justice or prevent starvation or improvement. But then the organization settled down into just trying to survive and getting enough dues to survive and slightly expanding their publications and maintaining what we used to call gate receipts, you know, just enough coming in through the front door that manages to keep you going. This is essentially death for any organization if it's not based